Today I want to talk about a very rare, but also very, very interesting engine configuration. If you were to observe this engine from the outside, you might be tempted to think, hey, look, it's just a really big single cylinder. But if you were to lift the cylinder head, inside you would find not one, but four pistons packed into a square. Hence the name, square 4. This engine configuration is in fact the most compact way possible to arrange four cylinders, because it's essentially as wide as a twin cylinder engine, which means that it's half the width of an inline 4, while also at the same time being shorter than a V-twin, and it achieves this amazing compactness while being very smooth and balanced. Despite these very important benefits, the square 4 engine never became widespread or popular, and today it's largely forgotten. But I think that it deserves a comeback, because today we can easily manufacture something that we could not back in the 40s and the 50s when this engine was in its heyday. So let's dive deeper into this interesting engine to understand it better. If we observe the cylinder head surface, we are going to see that it's completely flat, and that the cylinders are perfectly symmetric parallel to each other. We do not have an offset relationship like in a VR engine, for example. Also, if we find images of the pistons and the rods of the square 4 engine, we are going to see that we have perfectly conventional pistons and rods, whereas in a VR engine we would have slanted pistons to make it possible to attach all the pistons to a single crankshaft and still have a perfectly flat cylinder surface in a VR engine. What this tells us about a square 4 is that it's anatomically impossible for these four pistons to be attached to a single crankshaft. And indeed, inside the crankcase of the square 4, we are going to find not one, but two crankshafts. And here's a little 3D model of the square 4 that I made to help us understand and observe it more easily. But before we talk more about the engine, allow me to answer a question that I get asked in the comments very, very, very often, and that is, what kind of software do I use to make my engine animations? Now, for a very long time, the answer to that question was Fusion 360. However, now the answer to that question is Onshape. I have transitioned to Onshape, and the reason is really that makes my life easier. That's it. Onshape is 100% cloud and browser based. And that means that I can open it on any device at any time, anywhere in the world without needing to have anything installed on these devices. And also I never have to worry about time consuming and frustrating crashes and updates and any of that ever again. And also finally, because it's 100% cloud and browser based, the capacity of my device, and I have a bunch of weird devices, really is irrelevant. The RAM, the hard disk space, the ROM, the whatever, it doesn't matter because it's browser based, which means that I can run Onshape on my cell phone and also on my ancient garage laptop if I have to. The other reason why I'm using Onshape is that it allows me to be very, very lazy. See the Square 4 engine that I said that I made? Well, to be honest, I didn't really make it. Instead, what I did is that I went to Onshape's gigantic public library, and in the search bar, I typed two-cylinder engine. And I found it, and then I made a copy of it for myself that I can edit. That's one click. And I made two copies. The other copy, I flipped around, I did a phase offset on the crankshaft, and then I did a gear relation between the two crankshafts, and voila, square 4 engine. Took me about, I don't know, 2 minutes, maybe even less. The point I'm trying to make is that this public library is full. It's right there in the software. It is full. There's thousands upon thousands of files, all of which you can edit as you wish, play around with them. And overall, it's a very, very fun learning and also, if needed, time-saving experience, because there's really complex stuff, entire engines, all sorts of assemblies, parts, you name it. So if you're ready to transition to the next generation of CAD like me and millions have done already, head over to the links down below and give Onshape a try. Okay, now let's get back to the Square 4 engine. As you can see, what this engine essentially is two 180 degree twin cylinders fused together into a single block. But these two twins are not mirror images of each other. As you can see, when this piston of this pair goes up, The opposing piston of the other pair goes down. The result is that diagonally opposed pistons go up and down together. And this tells us that one crankshaft trails the other by 180 degrees of phase shift. So we have two pistons going up and two pistons going down together. Does this remind you of any other engine configuration? Yes, the inline 4. There we also have two up, two down together, and that means that the square 4 has the same firing interval as an inline 4. It fires every 180 degrees of engine rotation, so we have an even firing interval, which contributes to a smooth sounding and feeling engine. But despite the same firing interval, the different anatomy of the square 4 forces a different exhaust pipe configuration, giving the square 4 a very interesting soundtrack. Okay, what about the engine balance of the square 4? Let's start with primary. As we know, primary balances or imbalances primarily stem from the reciprocating mass of the piston. In the square 4, just like in the inline 4, when we have two pistons at top dead center creating two upward forces, the other two pistons are at bottom dead center creating two downward forces. The two forces cancel out the other two forces and we have a perfect primary balance just like in the inline 4, almost, not quite. Not quite because the square 4 is composed of two 180-degree inline twins. And each 180-degree inline twin has a rocking couple. Because we have one piston top dead center, the other piston bottom dead center, we have two forces of equal magnitude, opposite direction, offset by a perpendicular distance. So each inline twin is trying to sort of flip itself over to rotate itself. And the square 4 is two such inline twins, and so each half of the engine is trying to rotate itself in the opposite direction. It's creating a sort of torque about the engine. If we were to view this from above the engine, we would see that these two rotations are again forces of equal magnitude, opposite direction, offset by a perpendicular distance. So they're actually trying to sort of rotate the engine like this, rocking it like this, creating a little rocking couple of their own when you view the engine from above. This is very slight, barely noticeable, definitely not a significant vibration, but it should still be mentioned. What about secondary balance? As we know, secondary vibrations, they arise from the acceleration or deceleration that the changing angle of the connecting rod imparts onto the piston. If you want a more detailed, easier to understand explanation, you can always watch one of the older videos in my engine balance playlist. Now, secondary forces, they point up at both top and bottom dead center, and they only point down at mid-stroke. In the square 4, we have two pistons at top, two pistons at bottom dead center, so we have four secondary forces all pointing in the same direction, leading to poor secondary balance, just like in the inline 4. Now, secondary forces are much less noticeable and much weaker than primary forces, especially in motorcycles where we tend to have very small and lightweight pistons. So the square 4, in terms of balance, is just like the inline 4. Not really, because the square 4 has a little trick up its sleeve. Whenever you take something, let's say a crankshaft, and you spin it at very high speed, you are creating a gyroscopic effect. Think of a bicycle or a motorcycle wheel spinning at high speed. Such a wheel tends to resist being tipped sideways. It wants to remain stable. That's the consequence of the gyroscopic effect of the high-speed rotation of that wheel. In a motorcycle, the high-speed rotation of the crankshaft tends to resist being tipped sideways as well. So it makes the motorcycle harder to lean. We require more effort to get the bike to lean and change direction, which means that the bike is less agile. This effect is slight and it's really only noticeable when the bike is ridden at the limit aggressively, but it's still there. And that's, for example, the reason why certain Ducati V4 motorcycles, they have a crankshaft that is spinning in the opposite direction of the direction of the travel of the motorcycle. Now, in the square 4, we have two crankshafts. They are geared together, which means that one crankshaft is spinning in the opposite direction of the other. And that means that the gyroscopic effect of the crankshaft is canceling the gyroscopic effect of the other crankshaft, leading to a net zero gyroscopic effect of the engine as a whole onto the motorcycle, which means that the bike should have a better steering feel and it should be more agile and easier to lean over when being ridden hard at the limit. So the Square 4 has pretty much the same engine balance as an inline 4 while being more compact and without the gyroscopic effect. So why did the Square 4 die and the inline 4 spread like wildfire? Well, there are three main reasons. Reason number one, the first manufacturer to offer mass-produced Square 4 engined motorcycles, vehicles to the public was Ariel from the UK. Their bikes offered impressive performance for the time and were generally praised by journalists and the public, and they had a good reputation. They were pricey, because of course a crankshaft is a pricey precision machined item, and two crankshafts cost more than one. Also, the bikes were hand-finished and they had a lot of high-quality details and some, you know, fancy tech for the time and so on and so forth, so the crankshaft is just one reason behind the price. Perhaps a more important reason that didn't help the Square 4 is that there were two guys. One guy was called Quality Control and the other guy was called British Motorcycle Industry. And these two guys, they never met. One day, the Quality Control guy, he went to Japan and then after a few years came back to the UK with a bunch of Japanese bikes to obliterate British Motorcycle Industry. The second problem with the Square 4 is that the front two cylinders, they get all the cooling from the airflow. The rear two cylinders, they get nothing. So the rear two cylinders on early aerial bikes, they tend to overheat. This is irrelevant. It's really not a problem anymore because, well, nobody really builds air-cooled bikes anymore. Okay. 14% of the world's population doesn't have access to air-cooled bikes anymore. Okay, 7% of the world's population doesn't care about air-cooled bikes anymore. Is that good enough? The point that I'm trying to make is that liquid cooling solves all the overheating problems of the Square 4 engine. It's a problem of the past, the high temperature of the engine. The final problem, and this is the important one, this is realistically the only real drawback of the Square 4 engine, and it is that it has problems with breathing. Let's observe the layout from above, and let's say that we have two valves per cylinder like on the original Ariel Square 4 engines. These are our exhaust valves, and these are our intake valves. Attaching exhaust pipes is very simple, and we just put them on the outer sides of the engine, as in the Ariel. But the intake becomes tricky. When you realize that right above the valves, we have the valve springs and the cams and the lifters and so on, it becomes obvious how finding space for a decent intake manifold is very difficult. And indeed, as you can see on the aerial, we had a pretty small intake manifold with one carburetor feeding all four cylinders. This limited breathing capacity meant that the engine had to be oriented towards low speed torque rather than high speed screaming performance. It is in fact questionable whether four valves per cylinder would even make much sense on a Square 4 engine. This also explains why the Ariel Square 4 was the only mass-produced four-stroke Square 4. All the other Square 4s that came after, such as those from Suzuki or Kawasaki, they were all two-strokes. And that's because a two-stroke can ingest air and fuel through the crankcase and doesn't need valves and cams on top of the cylinder. That being said, technology has come a long way. The Ariel Square 4 used an ancient, cumbersome rocker arm setup and a modern setup where the camshaft is directly on the lifter bucket could buy some space, and I think that with some creativity and effort, four throttle bodies, or definitely two, could be mounted right on top of the engine, and then the fuel tank could either be reshaped or relocated somewhere on the motorcycle. The Square 4 can also do some pretty interesting things for cars because, number one, it makes a twin turbo setup on just four cylinders very, very simple, and because the engine is so compact, it actually buys space for a hybrid component, so it would work good in a hybrid drivetrain as well. I may be daydreaming a bit, but you know, fun stuff could definitely be achieved with the Square 4. But that's not all. There's one more ace up the square four's sleeve. And that is that if we choose to make the square four out of 270-degree twins instead of 180-degree twins, we can achieve pretty much perfect primary and secondary balance with just four cylinders. In a 270-degree twin, when one cylinder is atop dead center, the other is at mid-stroke. So if we implement that into a square four, we would have two pistons atop dead center and the other two at mid-stroke. That means two primary forces pointing up and no primary forces at mid-stroke, because that's when the piston has achieved peak velocity. It's not accelerating or decelerating, hence no force. This means that we now have imperfect primary balance. But remember, we have two crankshafts and primary vibrations occur at the speed of the crank, which means that we can easily restore perfect primary balance with crankshaft counterweights. When it comes to secondary balance, it's perfect pretty much out of the box. Secondary forces point up at top dead center and down at mid-stroke, which means that on a 270-degree twin, they simply cancel out. And of course, would do the same thing on the square four. Yes, they would create a very, very slight rotating couple, but honestly, it's so small that it's not even worth mentioning. So why didn't they make the square four out of 270-degree cranks before? Well, they didn't because before the advent of CAD and CNC machining, making and validating forging dies for 270-degree cranks was a nightmare. It was expensive, time-consuming, and filled with trial and error. So nobody was ready to spend a lot of money to create a crankshaft, which was back then seen as imperfect due to the uneven firing interval it creates. Nowadays, we know the benefits of a 270-degree crank, and we have the CAD and the CNC and all technology, so it's easy to make them, which is why everyone and their grandma is making a 270-degree twin nowadays. So to sum it up, a square four made from two 270-degree twins would have pretty much perfect primary and secondary balance, no gyroscopic effect, and it would sound like, I don't know, a V4 engine on steroids. So it would be overall pretty amazing, and I would love to see it. Of course, the chances of somebody pouring millions into developing an engine which has the benefits that only really appeal to engine nerds is slim. The chances are slim. We have to be realistic, but we can dream, can't we? Maybe one of those boutique high-end brands makes a limited run or something so we can at least hear it, or, you know, who knows? Anyway, as always, thanks a lot for watching. I'll be seeing you soon with more fun and useful stuff on the D4A channel.